we can go to.
Hello, my name is Lindsay O'Fries. I'm in the anthropology department here at Princeton. And I am very glad to be the moderator for today's panel on smelling law and urban space. Thank you to the organizers, Daniela Nofar, and everybody who's contributed to this conference. There are a number of questions that I see underpinning the talks thus far, such as how are we each limited and empowered by the sensorial realms that we inhabit? And how does law shape the sensorial? These are questions that Daniela encouraged that I think about when I was in a course with her last year that Eduardo Cadava spearheaded with A.L. Wiseman, both who are part of this this conference. And I just thought that as we turn now in this panel to the question of smell, it feels apt to me to bring up how the anthropologist Anna Singh has explored smell itself and the sensation of smelling as an entryway into acknowledging how we all are already influenced by one another. So first I would like to welcome Mariana Valverde, who is the professor at the Center for Criminology and Sociolegal Studies at the University of Toronto. I had a pleasure of attending your talk that was part of the Landscapes of Law conference last year. So we're all in for a treat, I can say that confidently. Her main research interests are sociolegal theory, moral regulation, and urban governance and law, historically and in the present. Sole authored books include Sex, Power, and Pleasure, The Age of Light, Soap, and Water, Moral Reform in English Canada, 1880s to the 1920s, Diseases of the Will, Alcohol, and the Dilemmas of Freedom, co-winner of the Herbert Jacobs Prize of the Law and Society Association, Law and Order, Signs, Meanings, Myths, Everyday Law on the Street, City Governance in an Age of Diversity, which also won the Law and Society Association's Jacob Prize, Chronotopes of Law, Jurisdiction, Scale, and Governance, and a forthcoming book for students, Foucault for and Against Criminology. In addition, she has co-edited 4 anthologies and published over 50 articles in journals ranging from Law and Society Review to Victorian Studies. Elected Fellow of the Royal Society of Canada in 2006, she was chief editor of the Canadian Journal of Law and Society from 2007 to 2014. In 2016, she received the Harry Calvin Award from the Law and Society Association. Her paper for today is titled The Eternal Return of Subjective Offensiveness in Local Law, Governing Unpleasant Smells.
Okay, thanks a lot. Actually, my paper is just called The Law of Bad Smells. The other title was overly pretentious. So I'd like to thank not only the organizers, but all of the people who are valiantly still here, despite the absence of any visible signs of alcohol or anything to make things a little easier. So I would buy you all around if we were in England and close to a pub or something. This paper, it's not really a paper. The remarks that may in the future become a paper seeks to develop ideas that I first published in 2011 in an article entitled Seeing Like a City, The Dialectic of Modern and Pre-Modern Ways of Seeing in Urban Governance. Researching the history of urban regulation for that piece led me to the conclusion that contrary to the claims about the hegemony of the modernizing seeing like a state gaze, claims made in different ways by James Scott, Michel Desarteau, Mary Pouvey, and many Foucauldian scholars. So contrary to the claims about the modernist gaze driving out localized ways of seeing, the legal history record suggests that in the field of urban regulation, it is not appropriate to sort of plunk down the story about quantification, expert knowledges, and abstraction as driving out older, situated, embodied, and contextual logics. Certainly the seeing like a state story does work for a lot of fields, but for other areas, including those that this conference seeks to highlight, modernist knowledges show no sign of having definitively defeated pre-modern situated ways of seeing problems and managing them. Among other things, I showed in that paper that today's noise regulations, which is important to say, are almost all within municipal jurisdiction, a point that Yishai will pick up on. Noise regulations demonstrate that even when local and state governments make an effort to modernize and objectivize the governance of unpleasant or disturbing noises, in practice, objective rules of general application never succeed. And in some cases, there is a dialectical reversal that puts in question the zero-sum seeing like a state story. So what I found studying noise regulation is that efforts to pass and to enforce codified rules end up leading to a return or a reactivation of older logics, particularly the pre-modern logic exemplified in the common law of nuisance. So here I'll briefly recap just one of the noise cases discussed in my article in a slightly different way, and then go on to explore the same issues in the context of recent Canadian legal disputes concerning bad smells. And I will show that the regulatory frustrations arising from law's inability to modernize and codify rules about offensive smells have given rise to a variety of different strategies. And here I'll mention three that I have found in some recent cases. I'm sure there's more, but three I have found that are used both to regulate and to not regulate the unquantifiable and the barely measurable. That is, bad smells that are not environmentally hazardous and thus escape codified pollution standards, but are offensive. Okay, so the noise bylaw case was decided by the Supreme Court of Canada in 2005. The question posed to the court concerned, you might think this is like sort of going from the sublime, the kinds of papers we were listening to earlier in the day, to the ridiculous, but bear with me. The question posed to the Supreme Court concerned the constitutionality of a Montreal noise bylaw that absolutely prohibited all noise that is produced indoors but is heard outdoors using electrical amplification. A bylaw that had been used against a strip club that was trying to lure customers into its premises by playing music through speakers directed to the outside. Now, Montreal is a city in the province of Quebec, which has a civil code on the French model. Now, because of that, one would think that Montreal would be able to set rules about noise, like codified rules, without having recourse to English nuisance law's extensive cultural repertoire, a repertoire that, as Davina Cooper showed in one of the few critical analyses of nuisance law that we have, features as protagonists thoroughly English gentlemen quietly enjoying their garden-surrounded property. But in fact, that isn't quite what happened. The sort of Quebec French-inspired codification didn't quite work. What is indeed French, or I guess, civil code about the Montreal bylaw, is that it uses the civil code standard to distinguish legal from illegal noise. And that standard is quite urban and cosmopolitan, unlike the suburban, almost rural bias of the common law, the English common law of nuisance. So the Montreal bylaw says that noise that is disturbing is illegal, but importing the language from the Quebec civil code, it declares that, quote, neighbors shall suffer the normal neighborhood annoyances that are not beyond the limit of tolerance that they owe to each other. But the cosmopolitan image of tolerant neighbors putting up with the inconveniences of urban living for the sake of its pleasures was at some point in the history of the city deemed insufficient. So to this older qualitative and situated standard, the city added an objective rule of general application that did not require proving that a noise was in excess of normal annoyances that must be tolerated. This clause, aimed at bars and restaurants, is the one that banned all amplified sound that can be heard outdoors. So it was under this modernist and codified section of the bylaw that the strip club was charged. The majority of the Supreme Court recognized that a total ban on all sound emanating from a building, at however low a volume, is a draconian measure. But they creatively read the second, more recent section, that is the total ban, in light of the older one invoking local standards of disturbance. So the majority of the court, faced with their difficulty, simply decided to trust that the local inspectors will not over-enforce the law. So, in a way, what the Supreme Court said is that they thought the inspectors would act as if they were adjudicating a nuisance case. So that's sort of the dialectical reversal of the codification project. Now, there was a dissent by Justice Ian Binney, and he exposed his colleague's contradictions and argued that the city needed to rewrite its over-inclusive bylaw. He declared, quote, "Noise is not by nature a nuisance." And then he went on to point out that as written, the bylaw would catch, quote, "people who can only make themselves heard using sound equipment, such as Dr. Stephen Hawking." End of quote. Of course, Stephen Hawking is nowhere to be found in Montreal. But adding another gentlemanly hypothetical, he added that, quote, "Article 9.1 would preclude a Montrealer sitting in his garden, listening to Mozart playing softly through an open window from a kitchen radio." End of quote. Law's inability to distinguish noise from music is something we could talk about over dinner or whatever. I find that really fascinating. I don't think there's ever been a successful effort to really define that. So like most municipalities, Montreal at a certain point had attempted to supplement and strengthen the old subjective standard of offensiveness by objective rules of general application. And yet the specter of nuisance, that ancient legal form that is thoroughly situated, intersubjective, and site-specific, comes back to haunt the court. And in two different ways, the majority chose to believe that street-level bureaucrats will manage the absurdities that result when one tries to codify a nuisance. And on his part, Justice Binney vainly tried to force city council to write a new bylaw that would in black and white distinguish among noises or forms of music, though it is not easy to see how this could have been done without reactivating the worst cultural biases of traditional nuisance law. This dialectic, this sort of failure of the codification, objectification project, it's a general feature of noise regimes. You'll just have to take my word for it. But I'll give you one little example. My favorite example is New York City's ordinance on the responsibilities of dog owners to control this species-specific noise known as barking. It's too bad Peter Goodrich and his dog are not here now. In a modernist reform effort, the city created a new rule that limited barking to 10 minutes in the daytime and 5 minutes at night. Now, I have no information on enforcement of this ordinance, and Peter has already gone back to New York, so he can't tell us if it's enforced. But it is clear that such objective rules will end up generating a need for a contrary supplement, the subjective, embodied, culturally biased standard of offensiveness that has long underpinned the common law of nuisance and which refuses to go away. So now turning to smells. Smells are even more elusive than noise for modernist law. There is no smell equivalent to decibels, at least not one that is accepted in Canada for legal purposes. Further, noise can be subject to rules about time. For instance, municipal codes always say that construction noise can only begin at 7 a.m. on weekdays, 9 a.m. on Saturdays, and so on. But while a resident who is keeping the noise diaries that municipal inspectors like to see can say that a particular noise started at 6:45 a.m., it is not so easy to pin down the start and end time for smells. I have a footnote here that I have to read in honor of our European colleagues. There has been some effort to quantify, to find a smell equivalent for decibels. A private company operating in Canada uses a machine called the European Odor Unit to measure smells. I don't know if it measures only European odors or what. The machine is reportedly like a scuba diving tank strapped into a backpack, with the ambient smells being fed into the machine through tubes. Now, the city of Vancouver considered using this machine to get out of all the difficulties of inspectors thinking, is this offensive or not, and we're multicultural, how do we enforce this? So they tried to use this machine, and they argued that it had been approved by the European Committee on Standardization. But the Provincial Environmental Appeal Board ruled that the machine or its measurements were simply too flawed to be relied on in court. So how do cities regulate conflicts about the sorts of experiences that in the Toronto Municipal Code are variously called noxious smells, obnoxious smells, or offensive odors? And I really want to emphasize that I'm only talking about the obnoxious smells, not the noxious one, because in relation to harmful chemicals, there is a seeing like a state gaze, and there are numbers and rules and so on. So I'm just going to highlight very quickly three strategies that are used to try to somehow govern the ungovernable offensiveness of smells. One strategy for addressing conflicts about non-harmful, unpleasant smells involves creating legal islands, such as the ones that protect an industrial use that might emit offensive smells but is considered a useful source of employment. This is the case in a sugar refinery near where I live, which is one of the last industrial properties in what was one a very industrial waterfront. So for that, a site-specific bylaw that only governs that one property states that while the firm is required to install noise and smell mitigating features, nevertheless, quote, noise from the Redpath factory is likely to be audible and odors may well be unpleasant, end of quote. The declaration that if one lives in the city, one must tolerate noises and smells is presented not as the normal state of city life, which is sort of what you see a little bit in the Civil Code of Quebec, but rather as an exception that suspends only for a named space the English-style sensibilities about quietly enjoying one's property that prevail in English-Canadian law. Now, a second different strategy is found in suburban areas where farming uses persist in the midst of galloping subdivision development. The Ontario Provincial Ministry of Agriculture has ensured that those who buy new homes in suburban subdivisions will not easily be able to impose their aesthetics on nearby farm properties. Specifically, the Farming and Food Protection Act of 1998 states that, quote, a normal farming practice cannot give rise to nuisance lawsuits from those who object to noises and smells. Actually, it's not just noises and smells. They have a bunch of other things, including flies and I forget what. So there's a whole bunch of things that are then excluded. And this is not unusual. For instance, there is a law in Connecticut that says that no agricultural or farming operation shall be deemed to constitute a nuisance, either public or private, due to odor from livestock manure and so on. Now, despite the legal protection granted to farming smells, a group of residents in the suburban fringe around Toronto launched the nuisance lawsuit against the operators of a mushroom farm. Now, the mushrooms themselves were not actors at all in the legal network. The conflict arose from the fact that the mushrooms are grown on compost that is made on the farm. The compost was made from a variety of organic materials and by all reports emitted extremely unpleasant smells. Asked to describe the smell, witnesses used very graphic images meant to convey, and I think not just to convey, but to produce disgust, and compare the compost smell to that of meat gone bad, carcasses, sewage, and a whole bunch of other things. I think the literary abilities of the witnesses were crucial to the success of the nuisance lawsuit. Because as Julie said earlier, it's extremely difficult to name smells. So they went out of their way. Now, the farm had already taken a lot of measures to try to mitigate the smell. They planted 500 trees around the property and built this giant wall made out of bales of hay and even hired an expert to try to measure the odors objectively. I think with this European odor unit that the judge is not in the least interested in the measurement question, so it doesn't appear in the judgment. But the complaints persisted. So it was in the latter part of that time period, in the late 90s, perhaps due to complaints about that mushroom farm, that the provincial government passed the statute about normal farming practices that I mentioned. So what happened then is that potential complaints were removed from the non-expert realm of the common law of nuisance and placed in a venue that is not that of expert knowledge, it's more trade knowledge. A quasi-judicial tribunal known as the Normal Farming Practices Protection Board. Now, since the new law provided complainants with access to a new tribunal, one would think that nuisance lawsuits would either have become impossible or have failed. But it was still possible, at least in rare circumstances, for neighbors to bring their grievances to court, which is what they did in this case. So the trial judge took the unusual step of claiming jurisdiction. This almost never happens because any of you who know administrative law, if there's a tribunal to be found, judges will say, oh, good, I don't have to deal with this. Off it goes to the expert tribunal. But the judge decided to give justice to the neighbors, and he claimed jurisdiction. And in fact, he ruled in their favor and somehow came up with a figure for damages. And didn't really give much explanation as to how much the annoyance of the horrible smell was worth, but he did come up with damages. He also claimed he could not have issued an injunction to have the mushroom farm stop its work, and there appears to be legal uncertainty about his power to issue an injunction and indeed about his jurisdiction altogether. Nuisance cases are very rare. Because of the existence of various kinds of environmental and other regulations, so he didn't have a lot to go by. Anyway, the mushroom farm appealed the decision, and then it went to the Ontario Court of Appeal. And the court split. Two justices upheld the trial judgment, and the other one agreed that a nuisance had been established, but said that the resident should have been heard by the expert board and not by a court. What is most interesting about the Ontario Court of Appeal decision for present purposes is that while disagreeing on the question of the proper forum, all three justices agreed that what is and is not a normal farming practice cannot be determined in a technical, objective manner. It depends on place and circumstance. And indeed, it seems like even this expert board, whose decisions are not publicly available, so I couldn't find them, but this board has ruled, for instance, that the noise-making machines that are used in vineyards to scare off birds so they don't eat the grapes constitute a nuisance when used to scare off foxes or raccoons in some other place. So what is a nuisance in one place is a normal farming practice in another. So it seems that all three judges agreed that what counts as a normal farming practice is context-dependent, thus kind of returning to the logic of nuisance. They also, all the judges also agreed that the fact that the residents had occupied their land far longer than the farm was relevant, which again is the nuisance principle, because if you move to a nuisance, you don't have as much right to complain about it as if the nuisance comes to you. Now, I found that really interesting because proving environmental pollution for regulatory purposes does not depend on whether the neighbors were there first or whether the noxious smells came later. It also does not depend on the literary abilities of the complainers, that is, their success at evoking disgust through vivid verbal descriptions of smells. By contrast, although the statute did empower a tribunal that depends on both expert and trade knowledges, the Ontario Court of Appeal chose to interpret the law in such a way as to reactivate the logic of nuisance. So they chose to subject the normality of the farming practices in question to the old test. Is this out of place? Like the now proverbial pig in the parlor instead of the barnyard invoked in the famous US Supreme Court Euclid decision. So my final example, a third quite different strategy for managing modern laws marked incapacity to target what people feel is offensive, is exemplified in a document that on its face reads like a classic seeing like a state exercise. This is a draft document soon to be released by the Ontario Ministry of the Environment entitled Odor Fact Sheet. A ministry employee told us that the document did not arise from a top-down effort to actually regulate smells, which is what you would think if you just saw the text. On the contrary, the purpose of this sheet is to enable ministry employees to occupy the complainers and make it seem as though the ministry is doing something and paying attention to them. The employee we spoke with had been asked to quote-unquote test drive the fact sheet when taking complaint calls, and she told us that except in the case of harmful chemicals that can be scientifically measured, smells defy state regulation. And the ministry does, again, like the judges who want to abdicate jurisdiction. The ministry wants to abdicate jurisdiction, but then they have this fact sheet that sort of masquerades as seeing like a state. The fact sheet, well, I'll just give you one bit of the fact sheet. If you experience an offensive odor in your community, record it in a daily journal. This information will help the ministry. Which actually is a complete lie, because if you keep reading down, what they do is give you the phone numbers of like municipal authorities or, you know, pollution hotlines or something. And then they try to give you categories by which to record smells. So this is answering Julie's question from this morning. Your journal should describe the following. One, quality of the odor. If the odor is offensive, please describe using descriptors such as, quote, fragrant, sweet, oily, paint, solvent, septic, rotten, medicinal, musky, or musty. How's that? And that's only one. And then there's two, intensity, three, frequency, four, duration, five, weather conditions, six, source. As I said, it's an amazing document because it really looks like some benthamite project gone wild. But if you keep reading, as I said, at the end, it abdicates jurisdiction and refers residents to municipal departments that might look into nuisance smells that are not dangerous, such as odors from restaurants. In conclusion, the law of bad smells shows that despite the forward march of modernist knowledges and expert opinions in some areas of law, in regard to the regulation of neighborhood annoyances that do not have physically harmful quantifiable effects, modernism cannot be instituted. Efforts made to objectify and codify the law of annoyances inevitably end up resorting to the logic of nuisance. The Supreme Court decisions on noise, the mushroom farm case, even the decisions of the quasi-judicial expert tribunal set up precisely to let the courts off the hook in these culturally fraught cases. In all of these, we see that the adjudicators cannot but return to notions of what is normal in the context. The Ministry of the Environment didn't seem to be fitting in with this because it elaborated a document that looked like modernist top-down regulation, but conversations with the employees in the line of sort of anthropology of documents kind of investigations revealed that this was just the state impersonating the seeing like a state gaze, because they certainly had no intention to actually regulate smells. They really just wanted to regulate the complainers. Justice Binney was the legal actor most uncomfortable with the rules that require a supplement of situated discretionary judgment. I mean, for all the years he was on the court, he was the most avid critic of anything like the police power of the state. However, his Mozart hypothetical does not exactly pave the way for a new, more modern, and constitutionally sound law of annoyances that would be suitable for an officially multicultural country. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Valverde. I'm excited to think about what you've just discussed alongside and against our next presenter, Ishai Blank. He's an associate professor of law at Tel Aviv University Faculty of Law and the former vice dean of the faculty. His areas of research and teaching include local government law, legal theory, administrative law, global cities, and urban legal policy. For the past 2 years, he has been a visiting professor in Sciences Po Law School in Paris. Over the years, Professor Blank was a visiting professor and other prestigious institutions throughout the world, including Cornell Law School, Queen's Law School in Canada, Brown University, Hamburg University, and the Oñati International Institute for the Sociology of Law in Spain. Some of his publications include The Geography of Sexuality, The Reenchantment of Law, Localism in the New Global Order, and The City and the World. His paper for today is titled The Smell of Cities.
So good evening and thank you. And I want to begin again by thanking especially Nofar and Daniela for organizing this fabulous event and for all of you for actually keeping up until so late. And unlike Mariana, actually my talk became, or at least the title became more, I would say, presumptive and a little longer. So, and I'll explain why. So now it's called actually The Taste and Smell of Cities, A Whiff of Critique. Cities are multisensory experiences. One of the traits that mark them and singles them out from other human habitations is indeed the attack that they launch against our senses. As Zimmel famously argued in his classic, The Metropolis and Mental Life, one of the reasons that urban life produces the famous blasé attitude is precisely this sensory intensity. Metropolitan individuality is erected, he claimed in the beginning of the 20th century, on the intensification, and I quote, of emotional life due to the swift and continual shift of external and internal stimuli. Unlike life in small towns and rural existence, urban life and the constant and rapid changes and differences that they entail create what Zimmel calls the sensory foundations of the unique mental life of the urban personality. And I cite again, the metropolitan type creates a protective organ for itself against the profound disruption with which the fluctuations and discontinuities of the external milieu threaten it, end of quote. And this organ, we know, is reason, rational attitude, and a mental predominance through the intensification of consciousness. Among the senses that seem to overwhelm the urban person, it is unclear whether smell figures at all or figures predominantly. Indeed, currently we seem to associate strong smells not with cities, but actually with the countryside, where farm animals are raised and where some other smelly, sometimes beautiful, sometimes horrible, natural phenomena take place. Or at least it is the case with urban centers in Europe and North America, and I will go back to that a little later on. Echoing Julie Saada's beautiful rendition, the project of cleansing European and American cities from their bad smells was an integral part of the emerging bourgeois sensitivity and the bourgeois subject and their newly constructed morals. It's interesting to note what a different attitude actually the urban bourgeoisie took. In Paris, it cleansed the city. In London and in the US, at least for a while, it simply fled the city. So it left the city to decay and just left for the suburbs. And in various renditions of early suburbanization in London, actually, there are depictions of how smelly the city was. So just what you needed to do was to escape it to the beautiful suburbs. Animals, slaughterhouses, the poor, all increasingly became the bearers of bad moral traits as well as bad odors and were gradually marginalized and excluded from, again, at least Western or Northern cities, Northern global, that is. Animals were a preliminary target of this sensitivity. In their study of Baltimore, Boston, Philadelphia, and New York during the 19th century, Brinkley and Vitiello found that municipal ordinances to remove farm animals from city limits set the tone for the planning profession in its entirety, aligning it with the field of public health in creating a hygienic city. This is also in line with Dirk Hartog's very famous Pigs and Positivism, where he described the expulsion of pigs from New York City during this same period. The exclusion of animal, farm animals, that is, from cities is particularly interesting as it is closely tied to the humanization of our cities. While we think of seeing and of hearing, of touching and of tasting as extremely human traits, smelling belongs to the realms of dogs, cats, cows, and pigs. Although there exist, of course, exquisite smells, and humanity has forever been invested in producing pleasant odors, natural smells are by and large excluded from our newly constructed civilization. Piss and feces, sweat, bed breath, these most basic and naturally produced smells are a source of anxiety, shame, control, and exclusion. And while we often think of ourselves, again, as seeing, touching, hearing, and tasting creatures, we hardly think it is particularly human to smell. Actually, it is quite animalistic, again, as Julie suggested. Furthermore, contrary to the paralyzing fear people experience when imagining themselves blind and deaf, losing their sight and hearing sense, and to the impossibility of actually imagining oneself often without touch, losing one's smell or being smelling impaired, insomniatic, seems almost benign. Thus, our cities, as what is becoming the markers and emblems of civilization, and it has not always been the case, our cities are also becoming growingly odorless. And I think here it would be also interesting actually to think about Anne's comment, they're not really becoming odorless, but we become insensitive to various odors, such as gas, etc., but actually to be hypersensitive to other smells. And it is no coincidence, perhaps, therefore, that smelly animals, horses, pigs, cows, and chicken again, were the first to be excluded from our modern cities, so they can become properly and purely human. Having lived with us for thousands of years, they have been effectively banished from our towns over the past few centuries. And this banishment, again, has been so effective and so completely that trying to imagine our cities, Paris, New York, London, with animals seemed like such a crazy exercise. And it has always been, it has only been about 150 years since they actually left our cities. And even today, when we think, of course, of the animals that do exist in cities, which are dogs and cats predominantly, and a little bit of rats, then the only thing we can tolerate is when they are leashed. And very hard, therefore, to see stray cats. As we know, it's rather hard to leash cats. And one of the interesting things is that when people come and visit me in Tel Aviv and they see how many stray cats are there in Tel Aviv, they say, well, we didn't realize Tel Aviv was such a third-worldly city. And yet smell persists. Everything smells. Humans, trees, concrete, marble, malls, shops, foods, restaurants, and kids. Every city has its own smell and its own tastes. And indeed, here I go to the title of my talk. Although I started off writing this, again, it's not a paper yet, it's I hope it will be, on smell only, but as I read and wrote, I realized that my senses actually merged, and I had a synesthetic experience, because as I was thinking about and reading about smell, I actually kept running into taste as well. And therefore, I couldn't stop but realize that I had to change the title and also my focus and think about what is called the chemosensory system, which is the smell and taste together. Smell and taste mix, mingle, they are inseparable. Indeed, while the regulation on smells seems to be rather stagnant these days, that is, that there are not many, many new developments, and of course, Mariana's analysis is brilliant and enlightening, but that seems that most of the more novel innovations, at least in the legal realm, is around the regulation of foods and tastes. And here I will give some examples from which I would like to afterwards think together with you a little bit about what is distinct about these new legal developments and what, how can we try to think about them. So the first, a few months ago, the fair city of Verona, of Romeo and Juliet, prohibited the opening of new kebab and other ethnic shops, ethnic food shops. And I'm quoting, "Thanks to this provision, there will be no more opening of establishments that sell food prepared in a way that could impact the decorum of our cities," said Flavio Tosi, Verona's mayor. The mayor even flaunted Verona's status as a UNESCO World Heritage City to justify even further the importance to protect its tradition, one which obviously does not include kebab and other ethnic shops. So if you're wondering, sushi and French cuisine is not ethnic. Verona was joining other cities throughout Italy. Lucca, Bergamo, Prato, and Genoa have passed similar city ordinances, stemming from their traditional role as business licensing authorities. So here, a small legal point, how come the cities can even do that? Very easy. They are usually and traditionally, both in common law and in civil law countries, responsible for planning, zoning, and business licensing, and often also for preservation of culture and tradition, and this is how they do that. Legal challenges for sure will ensue, and perhaps the European Court of Justice will save the city of Verona from itself, to go back to this theme. Yet such efforts will undoubtedly continue. Second example of cases. A few years back, the Municipal Council of Toronto in Canada passed an ordinance prohibiting the selling of shark fins. Shark fins are a rare food considered a unique delicacy, highly desirable by various ethnic groups, mostly Chinese. The decision was justified, again, by the Municipal Council on the basis of the cruelty that sharks suffer from the practice, including their being cut alive and being thrown back into the sea, left to bleed to death. A petition to the court against the municipal bylaw was successful. The judge found that the city exceeded its authority since the purpose of the bylaw was beyond the geographical boundaries of the city. The well-being of sharks, because they are outside of the city limits, and there was no general welfare or health consideration that the city could justify its action. So the general welfare and health are simply the terms that often the legislation, the authorizing legislation actually has. There are general welfare provisions and other kind of more specific provisions that will allow the city to actually act. The court invested a lot of time explaining the importance of limiting the city to its boundaries. And let me get back to that later. The same line of examples, let's consider the fact that all over the US, including some states, especially California, prohibited the selling of foie gras. Although last year the California federal court overruled and quashed the ban on foie gras to the delight of many restaurateurs, since it encroached on the federal domain, the point remains. Cities serve as locations for battles over the morality of our tastes and of our foods. Indeed, food is becoming, once again perhaps, a moral issue. And let me here add that having grown as an Orthodox Jew, a lot of my battle as I grew up was actually to get rid of the various moral prohibitions on many, many foods. And therefore, whenever I see that returning, I experience that as kind of a return of very familiar modes of prohibition on foods. Just the third and kind of smaller type of cases involve various health prohibitions on food, but not just the mere sanitary ones, but kind of a new wave of health justifications. Cities throughout the world attempt to prohibit sodas, Big Macs, fast food, and in some other instances, genetically modified foods. Indeed, eco-thinking and deep ecology seems to motivate many of these kind of new health risks that cities, again, kind of regulate our taste and foods. Okay, so what connects these and what separates these city actions with respect to smells and tastes? First, there are obvious and important differences, and I wouldn't want to be read as kind of flattening out or disregarding the crucial kind of differences. Obviously, regulating against immigrants is very different than regulating in order to protect and defend sharks and geese. And prohibitions on the basis of health panic are distinct from both. Indeed, these local regulations and prohibitions reveal the many functions and different projects, the immense possibilities in law. And that is a thing that I wouldn't want to kind of disregard or not to seriously think about. And thinking through the Foucauldian models, as Judy Saada again suggested, and also kind of the comparison that Mariana between the two forms of law, one which is the kind of the planning and the other which is more the nuisance, we can think of also of the disciplinary and of governmentality elements, of course, of these various modes of local regulation. Classifying, creating hierarchies, excluding, controlling and managing populations as well as human subjects. We can also perhaps think even about the interpolation and about how we are being called into a certain type of subjectivity through these modes. And however, I want to point to two connecting themes that I would like to think about between these kind of new modalities or new types of municipal regulation, and which seem to mark the specifics of the local legal form, unlike the national legal form. And here I want to kind of to think about the question, why are these things actually at the local level? Why weren't they simply done at the national level? Wouldn't it be more natural, more reasonable, more commonsensical to actually just have that as a national legislation? So the first is what I would like to think about is the growing morality of cities and their becoming reservoirs for moral aspirations and political programs. As against the image of cities as economic growth machines, magnets for the creative class, and whatnot, and of course I'm referring here to both kind of the very strong, powerful model of Saskia Sassen of the global city and Richard Florida's image of the what cities do is they attract the creative class. It's us, if you were wondering. So cities insist, despite these images, on being moral and political repositories. While some such aspirations are laudable and some are reprehensible, and I'm not flattening that, but this is the kind of the joint thing about them, the fact is that these are political and ideological positions often taken as against the national government, not with it. Mm-hmm. Cities take positions on the most contentious questions of our time, often responding to national politics and morals, or to other cities. So sometimes there will actually be a get back, kind of a retaliation among cities. And in this sense, what I want to add is that kind of, I think that it is the next stage after what Julie was describing, which is the emergence of the bourgeois sensibility or sensitivity, that we're already beyond that, in a sense. This is no longer just the bourgeois. This is actually a real site of contestation where cities are perhaps once again these battlegrounds for various ideological and political projects. The unique legal form here, whether it is the nuisance form or planning, as Mariana Valverde just again beautifully argued, what is unique here is that it is local and probably reaching realms which would have been seen as more naturally, again, kind of national. So why does it happen at the local level? Again, how do and why do cities become these moral agents or political sites or sites for political contestation? So one is, again, legally speaking, this is what localities do. Okay, so you can say they're simply, it's really legally available. They are anyway doing zoning and planning and business licensing and all these things that are naturally tied to these things. So it's just available. So that is one answer, but I think that it's slightly less convincing. The second is that the federal government or the national government in kind of unitary systems simply cannot do that. And here we kind of begin to get there, which has to do with the ossification or the kind of congealment of a lot of national politics. So you will simply not get to the agreement or the consensus over such crazy ideas as banning kebab or a laudable idea as banning shark fins. There's just no way in which you can do that. And this, again, kind of gets me to the third point, and this is that localities can reach such political agreements more easily and more readily because they are more radical and extreme in their political form. And this kind of goes to the point that for Americans it will be known, the point of James Madison in the Federalist Number 10 of the fear of the sect. Right? So of course Madison depicts localism as highly dangerous because the way he says it, national minorities can become local majorities and adopt crazy programs such as paper money and giving up on debt. Right? So these are kind of the radical socialist programs of Protestants of the time. And for Madison, it poses a risk. So kind of the analogy to that would be these very radical ideas that can only materialize at the local level. So these ordinances take place simply because individuals can actually impact their locality more than they can impact or even dream of impacting their national or provincial or state, depending on where we are. And in this sense, they insist on, and this is the other kind of thing, they insist of infusing their politics, of course, with moral and ideological convictions very deeply held. And in this sense, it ties to the new democratic discourse surrounding cities that even sees them as the purer forms of democracy, one that we have completely and forever lost at the national sphere. The second kind of thing that ties some of these developments, not all of them, is that cities are responding to and participating in the globalized constellation in which they are partaking. And this is kind of I would say a different take than Sassen's take on the global city. So the global city isn't just a site for of course multinationals and global capital and all these things, but actually of global involvement, kind of depicted in the idiom of the think globally, act locally. So you think about the globe. How do you think about that? You do something in your locality. It's not that we simply have cities as global cities, bureaucratic governmental entities, economic beings or neoliberal creatures. They are actually global actors insofar as they act even within their own geographically delimited boundaries. And here kind of we see the, I would say, kind of the detachment and the disconnect that the judge in the shark fin case experiences. We kind of clings to the boundaries of the city and says, well, there's no effect, there's no harm that we can actually point into our inner, into the limits of the city, completely ignoring the new connections that actually feel towards, well, we can say distant suffering, to use Boltanski, but to really kind of the tentacles that people experience are not weaker, even if the harm is actually done anywhere else. And here we can also think about various projects of boycotting that happens at the local level, in which people again express kind of their global ties and their global attachments. Okay, so just now for the ending paragraph of the whiff of critique. The sensitive ability to smell, sniff, and detect is what also perhaps signifies critique itself. Nietzsche wrote, as I previously said in Ecce Homo, my genius is in my nostrils. And his critical genealogical prose is filled with smell metaphors. Are they indeed just metaphors, or was he in fact really smelling? Maybe he was really synesthetic, especially in genealogy of morals. Does critique have a smell then? Or is smelling critical? What is the smell of critique? Does it have the smell of the olfactory of moral values, as Nietzsche was so appalled by? What can we gain by insisting on smelling or on sniffing? And I won't do the Trump, as Tom suggested yesterday. Will we discover something that our minds, our eyes, our ears cannot discover? I'm not sure, although I think we need all to hope that we can recruit different and new tools and perhaps organs on which critique can base itself. So, as Heraclitus observed, if everything were turned to smoke, the nose would be the seat of judgment.
Thank you very much, Professor Blank. I have many questions for both of you, but let's open it to the floor.
So I have two questions for both of you. Well, thank you very much for your wonderful presentations. So I start with Mariana. You concluded your presentation by saying that, in a way, the cases you presented are the demonstration that modernism couldn't apply to this. But I'm wondering if it's perhaps a sort of pervert mise-en-scène of the fact that in this case, law is able to, in a way, to detect subjective needs, or I mean, the fact that the law represents the possibility not in a way, that in these cases, because you described a lot of procedures through which a single citizen can call the city and, in a way, claim it's his own or her own displeasure or so on. I'm just wondering if it's a sort of sphere where the law is representing its capacity of taking also in consideration this kind of subjective needs and not only the objective aspects of reality. I don't know if the question is clear. And I have a question is, or a remark for Ishai. I mean, a part of this case of neo-fascist cities like Verona or Lucca, but perhaps in Italy the great problem about food is the fact that a lot of there is a through the European Community, there is a lot of legislation about food, about taste, and about healthy kind of food. And perhaps there is also a sort of, you spoke about that, but there is a very, very strong dialectic on this kind of level, that it's the city try to redefine its own identity against this kind of homogenization of supposed homogenization by the produced by the European Community, and there is this kind of dialectic between the local and the global, the globalization of Europe and the reproduction of an authentic cultural identity of the local. Also, because Italy has not a unique or an homogeneous identity. Italy is just a composition of different identities, civic identities. So it's.
I'm not exactly sure I understood your point. Did you mean that why would, well, either municipalities or courts or whatever still be interested in hearing these disputes that are just sort of subjective cultural things about I find this offensive or not? Is that?
Yeah, it's in a way, they, in this way, they can also prove that they are able to also to hear this kind of morally subjective.
Yeah. Well, I think that Ministry of the Environment sheet is the brilliant invention here, because it makes it seem as though the annoyances that people do suffer. It is really annoying to have a neighbor whose dog barks all night, but for various reasons, modern legal tools are really find it extremely difficult to cope with that because they keep trying to come up with rules like the only 10 minutes at night. Well, okay, fine. So what you see in this whole field of disturbances, whether it's smell or noise or anything else, is this constant kind of abdication of jurisdiction, abdication of responsibility. Oh, well, yes, it's very annoying, but we can't do anything about it. But you want to be seen to be listening to the public, because in this day and age, governments can't afford to just say, oh, that's not in the municipal code, so goodbye, you know, go away. I mean, maybe they say that in some jurisdictions, but certainly in a place like Canada, it's not really feasible to just say, well, we can't regulate that, so you just have to live with it, right? So the odor fact sheet I thought was really clever because it made it look as though there was this sort of quantification and the citizen was being recruited into this Benthamite project to really cleanse the city of smells. Well, of course, no such thing was going on. But the format and the content, too, of the sheet made it seem as if. And in fact, this is, you know, this eternal problem of disturbances and annoyances, right? I mean, my son now works for a local city councillor, and he's only been working there for 3 weeks, but he's already got this project, which is to come up with a way to govern the people who are constantly phoning to complain because they want parking permits or they want speed bumps or something. So he's the parking guy in the office. And so he says, oh, I've come up with this idea that they need to do a petition. They need to go and talk to all of their neighbors, and you need to have a petition. At least more than 50% of the neighbors, you know, want something. So it's part of this thing too, right? So trying to somehow make it seem as though the constant annoyances of city life are being dealt with when they're actually, I mean, they're not ungovernable, but they're not governable through codified rules. So there's this sort of effort to make it seem as though you're doing something, but really you can't do anything about it. I mean, you can have rules about what kind of restaurants you have or something, but disputes between neighbors really resist any kind of modernist kind of governance, and any authority, whether it's a tribunal or a court or a municipal inspector, finds it very uncomfortable to just mediate and just, you know, come up with some arbitrary thing. So and I think that says something quite profound, not about law, but about the whole kind of James Scott narrative of seeing like a state. Like that's where I think my story has some bite, because it isn't the case that the seeing like a state gaze drives out everything. There's just all of these ways in which the logic of offensiveness and situated knowledge of what is disturbing just will, you know, keep recurring. So I don't know if that fills it out a bit more.
Yeah, so I don't have a lot to say except for that I really agree with you. So clearly there is a dialectics there being played with the reassertion and kind of reclaiming a local identity vis-a-vis global encroachments. So it can be the EU, and it can be in many, many instances, not just, of course, of food and taste, but on many, many other instances. And it can be both at the local level and sometimes at the national level, where you would also have that. So obviously, I think that you're right in the sense that I need to also read that not just as a crazy kind of over-response, as you suggested.
It is crazy. I mean, the national identities for food, it's
not. Yes. Yeah. No, but again, I think that reading it as a form of anxiety is also necessary. And if we really want to get to the bottom of it, now it doesn't mean that it's not neo-fascist, but that it is a poor, yeah. So I agree about the dialectics that it's not just about participating in the global, it's also the resisting of the global. And clearly, in the case, it is also the resisting of the immigration. Right? Yeah. I mean, so not just the EU, but the immigrants, clear. Yeah.
But cities could just as easily go the other way and be more progressive.
Right. So, there's the flip side in other cases where you have refuge cities and things like this. So, again, it's kind of an extreme form of politics without the mediating elites and also the mediating kind of that against any radical program for the right, you would have the radical program of the left. Or at the national level, they kind of will balance each other out. Mm-hmm. At the local level, you simply don't have often the balancing. And you have the very radical political programs.
Hi. Thank you very much for both presentations that were very interesting. I have a question that connects Mariana's presentation to Julie's presentation and brings us to the 19th century. And I wanted to draw an analogy between the market and the market of smells, so to speak. So my question is, by saying that the state cannot regulate, it implies that law is not there in the interactions of the city, in the way we smells are distributed in the market of senses, in a way. So I wanted to ask if how you think we can, in a way, incorporate the realist critique of the free market idea into your presentation, and take into consideration the fact that by not regulating, the state is regulating. So municipal law is in fact always there, even when it's not regulating or purports not to regulate. And I wanted to think how we can bridge that and incorporate into your idea the realist critique of the free market idea.
I try to be quite specific and talk about municipal regulation, and so, but maybe I slipped into the language of law's inability to regulate as much, which is nonsense, because, you know, clearly there is all of this other regulation, like the sugar factory down the street from my house certainly is regulated in a million different ways, including the ISO standards and, you know, things like that. So I should have been more rigorous and just said, neither the municipality nor the courts can regulate disputes between neighbors about what constitutes offensive smells, which is much more specific, because obviously there's all these other regulatory apparatuses that produce the factory and, you know, sort of are involved in all kinds of things and that, you know, produce a lot of car traffic as normal. I might find it annoying, but, you know, I don't drive, so I find car traffic annoying. But, you know, it's normalized, right? So, yeah, so, I mean, I think one has to be quite specific and always be thinking about law and regulation and all the multi-jurisdictional things, and certainly something like the ISO, if you were going to look into the law of restaurants, you know, the ISO is probably as powerful or more powerful in regulating the meat that gets to the restaurant that is going to make into a kebab than anything. As actually a Mexican friend of mine was telling me that the city of Mexico launched a successful campaign so that its own health and environmental standards would not be trumped by the ISO. This is part of the fight back against global law of a capitalist sort of free trade kind of variety. So that would be interesting too. So, I mean, it's hard, right? Because it's hard to talk about the interactions of all these different regulatory regimes. And both Ishai and I are quite interested in the specificity of municipalities, which is something that's not usually talked about. So maybe we emphasize that a lot and not really looked at all the zillion positive regulations that are going on. I mean, that mushroom farm, I'm sure, is regulated a zillion different ways, you know, labor law, zoning, blah, blah, blah. There's just bad smells as perceived by the neighbors. That's not actionable.
Yes. Does that work? Yeah. So, yeah, thank you. Thank you, both of you. I mean, I really enjoyed the two presentations. I want to go back to your last paragraph, Yishai, about smell and critique. So, because this is something that we just, I mean, in many of the lectures, the idea was that this synesthesia, this aesthetic turn, call it the way you want, going back to smell, was actually interesting for critique as such. Is that so? So I can very well see, I have a first argument to say yes, of course, and that would be that the critique of reason, reason being the vision of the mind. So, and by the way, the vision of the mind is critical of the vision, the ordinary vision. So reason as criticizing immediate appearances in order to find a better vision, which is the vision of the mind. So it is disturbing and destabilizing to say, well, but how does that smell or how does that taste? Does that make it critical as such? I can very well see how no. So one, that first critical moved on, I can very well see how it can fall down into uncritical ways of smelling, if I may say so. But I would like you to... So what do you think, dear?
Okay, so I have to admit that, as you saw, it was not a very well-developed point. So I wouldn't, make up as if it is. But I would say that my tendency here is not to abstractly think of, you know, the embodiedness of ourselves, etc., but to actually, at least at first point, because I don't think that, you know, we can really understand what it means to smell critically, kind of nonsensically, but it would be actually to rely a little bit more on our senses and on a variety of senses when we think about things. So it can be actually a really banal suggestion that actually when you walk and you would sniff, but literally sniff, and you smell something different, then you would look at yourself as a detective that finds various clues. And I actually have to say that the whole thing for me started by my strong intuition that whenever I land in a city, it really smells different. So I have, and it's hard to kind of pinpoint it into words, we don't have the vocabulary, but I know that when I land in Paris, what strikes me is a whiff of Paris, and every city kind of that I get to know smells differently. And I think that we often kind of just don't think about that when we do really take into account when something looks different. So I would say, you know, at first what I'm just saying, let's think of ourselves as a little bit more animalistic and sniffing around, literally sniffing around, and what does it mean? No more. It's not that radical, and maybe it's not that critical. And of course, smells, I think like also came in the previous panels, can be highly uncritical. It can be immediate, it can be repulsive, which means get these smelly things out of my sight. So it's not about seeing the smell as kind of the judgment of the smell as final, but to actually treat smell as another faculty, as important as, as touching or as seeing and listening. It's really underdeveloped, so we don't really smell, and part of the thing here for me is also how disturbing it is that we are kind of banishing extreme smells and various other smells, and what do they mean? So it's both a result, right? I mean, the denigration of smelling, and also a self-incapacitation in a sense.
You know, you have the precedent, so you generated jurisprudence, but it was
open. Oh, was it? Was it really? Oh, so sorry. That's even sadder in that case. So I have a question, Yishai. At a certain point in your presentation, you hinted at food prohibitions, that you hinted at them, and obviously I thought immediately of some sort of legal, theological prohibitions, I don't know. And that made me think of the food and smell and taste regulations in some of those cities you were talking about. And that we talk about immigrants or we talk about refugees, but in a certain way we don't talk about something else that is also perhaps, I don't know, I'm just asking, is going on. Is the political, theological underpinnings of certain regulations in Western cities and how they want to preserve a certain Christian tradition, and that there are smells that do not point specifically to just immigrants, but to specific immigrants from certain religions that smell religion, that smell a different theological group, that smell a different kind of legal community, that smell a different kind of political organization, that smell to certain kind of effort, which is one of the meanings of jihad, and so on and so forth. So the question is there this kind of theological, political underpinnings that, you know, underlie, that go underground, that we do not want to recognize, that in a certain way actively avoid to talk about, but somehow are linked to that? So is there a religious smell, so to speak? Is there a theological smell going on in there?
Well, I think it's more culturally specific than just Christian, because certainly all my work on the history of municipal regulation, it's so imbued, not just, I mean, it just doesn't specify enough if you say Christian. I mean, it's true, it might exclude all kinds of things, but oftentimes in North American cities, there is this great effort to not look like a third world city, which may or may not be racist. I mean, it is, but it's more than that. And then there's also this installation in law of English, sort of the values of the English common law. I mean, I only had this little thing about Justice Binney imagining himself sitting on the balcony listening, you know, to Mozart. But if you ever read the history of nuisance law, you would just be struck by, you know, all these cases, like, you know, an English court deciding that, well, this lady was really disturbed by the constant playing of cricket immediately outside her house. But cricket was a gentlemanly sport, literally, so it was okay. So local law, and I think you're, you know, getting at some of this, is, you know, a great venue for the expression of certain cultural preferences that in secular multicultural countries are very difficult to express at the national level, and in any case there isn't necessarily the desire, you know, for that. So it's, I mean, it can be anti-Muslim, like the burkini bans, you know, which is sort of the big thing in certain parts of Europe. But I think in many cases it isn't just anti-something. And I mean, you know, it's very easy to say, oh, this is racist, that is racist. We can all see that. I think what isn't often seen is the other side of it. Like, okay, whose preferences are being installed as the norm? And certainly something I've been struck by, maybe because I originally come from Barcelona, which is such an urban kind of place, is the garden, you know, the, like, nuisance law is all about, you know, the quiet enjoyment of one's property. And it's all from the point of view of the property owner of a suburban house. It's just like, that's what it's about. And if you live in an apartment, you basically have no recourse in nuisance. That's what it boils down to. So there is this, you know, yeah, I mean, all I'd say is instead of always looking at the hatred part of these things. Okay, the anti-kebab legislation, well, obviously, I mean, that's like, it doesn't take anything to see what that's against, but what is it for? So is there some kind of cultural legal mechanism to protect the Neapolitan pizza or something? I mean, French champagne rules and French cheese rules would be interesting to look at. What is being protected? Instead of always looking at the exclusionary side, because we all know about how local law is used for exclusionary purposes and, you know, in the US history of racial segregation and so on. But the installation of certain cultural preferences, which are often not likely to be the actual preferences of the people who live there if you took a poll, because the Englishman sitting in his garden is a figure that has lived in law a lot longer than it has in actual reality. So I'm really interested in that. The aesthetics of standards.
Yeah, so just maybe a quick response. So one kind of very banal positive, or on the verge of the positive and of the exclusionary, would be overt religious prohibitions, right? So of course in Israel would be the example of the pork. So again, it's not against anyone, even though it is also against various Jewish immigrants, especially from previous Russia, that when they started emigrating to Israel in the 90s, localities all over Israel started enacting strict bylaws to prohibit the selling of pork. Now, again, it wasn't really against them, even though it was also motivated by that, but it was an instantiation of religious law. In India now, there is a renewed war over beef. And again, that takes place because of the Hindu right, and it takes place again at the level of localities often, where suddenly the anti-beef legislation is either being enforced or being reinstantiated, etc. So that's kind of one, but I would say more the obvious. And I think, though, that you were looking for perhaps something which is more, as you said, like political theology. And here I actually would like to hear if you have some suggestion about that, because I actually don't think that it's Christian. So I'm not sure that the structure that you were hinting is necessarily Christian. So there might be a theology going on there, and to that I was hinting. So one of the reasons, at least, that is given for the prohibition on eating pork in Judaism is because the pig represents hypocrisy, right? So I won't get into why in Jewish theology it represents hypocrisy, but this is the reason, right? And there's a whole, again, going back to Maimonides also, kind of explaining why Jews don't eat certain types of foods, is there is a moral reason for that. So in this sense, I was suggesting that there is a theological underpinning, if you will, to the return of the moralization of food. And that was my thing. So one level, overt, pork, beef, and things like this. Another kind of more political theology is the moralizing of food. Yeah. And that can go in the yeah. foie gras and the shark fin and the various other... Of course. Right. And that's what I said, kind of the deep ecology. So you have a renewed moralization of food. Mm-hmm. And you see it most clearly at the local level. Again, mm-hmm. for the reason that I was trying to explain.
So it's past 7:30. Unfortunately, we need to end. But we will be able to continue this conversation. Thank you, everybody.